Hey guys, so Jonathan here for Guitar Interactive, and we are joined by Matt and Padge from Bullet for My Valentine. How are you guys doing today?
Good, thanks. Yeah, very good, thank you.
Yeah, good. Now, as we're just coming out of the studio there, you've got it all fully set up as it's going to be on this tour. Coming to a place like this to do your rehearsals, is this just a normal sort of setup for you guys?
It is for the bigger shows, festival season, big headline shows, stuff like that. Yeah, obviously, you've seen from yourself, it's quite a lot of stuff going on. So you need somewhere which just has the space and the abilities to do proper production rehearsals.
Yeah, it was just that sort of thing that, you know, you come in sometimes see some rehearsals, but to actually see it set up, like, I mean, I'm ready to see like a festival show right now, you know. Now we've got 10 days to wait, or nine or 10 days for download. How important has that festival been for you guys?
It's massively important to us. You know, we were there in 2004 for our first ever time, when we were actually an unsigned act. We didn't have any release out. There was nothing, you know, and Andy Copping and Paul Ryan, who took us on as an unsigned act, who's still our agent to this day, took a bit of a punt with us, and thankfully we didn't let them down, and here we are, what is it, 14 years later? So still doing it, and it's you know, a highlight of the calendar, should we be on it. We haven't done it for 5 years, so it's going to be a very, very important, very cool show for us to do, you know.
Fantastic.
It's going to be awesome.
Yeah, you know, I was definitely there at the 14 years ago, and I can remember seeing you, and it was there was a lot of buzz then, even then for you guys.
Yeah, I think that was the whole point of us being there. You know, there was a lot of buzz going on, and you know, I think it's quite rare that an unsigned act gets to play Download, you know, but we did it, and you know, we've proved our worth, I think.
So Gravity, completely new sound, I would say, for you
guys.
I've heard the whole record.
Okay, yeah, we never know who's here.
And I think it's an absolutely awesome record. It's a bit of a departure, though, from your previous records.
Mm-hmm.
Can we talk a little bit, before we get into the songwriting, let's talk a little bit about the production on there, because that's, the main difference in there. Who worked with that, and what was the idea behind that production?
Well, the producer was a guy called Carl Bowne, who co-produced Venom with Colin Richardson, and then he did Don't Need You, standalone single at the end of 2016. And I think for me, I was just kind of at the driving force of creatively that wanted to do something different sonically and songwriting. You know, I just wanted to do something we'd never done before. Mm-hmm. I thought that after Venom and a lot of the stuff before even Venom, you know, we'd taken the band as far as we could in a certain direction. So just kind of had a bit more of a kind of creative, I don't know, leap of faith, without excuse the pun, and wanted to do something different and a bit more contemporary and heavier. You know, a lot of people have that word that means a lot of things to different people.
Yeah.
But to me, this album has so much more weight than anything we've done in the past, which to me makes it heavier, you know? So yeah, but it's, you know, it was a departure in some ways, but it's, you know, I think it's the best thing that we could have done at this time, you know? And it was difficult to convince these guys to jump on board without, you know, it's hard to try and give someone a vision when it's in your head without giving them an example of what that vision is, you know. It required a lot of kind of trust and faith in these guys and me, but I think now that it's done, it kind of all makes a lot more sense than it did a year ago.
So for you, Padge, like hearing these tracks at first, because obviously you would just be hearing the sort of kernels of them.
Yeah.
I mean, what was the sort of you pulling against it?
I mean, it's not super different, but you know, obviously that it is different to anything we've done before. You know, we've lent ourselves heavily to the digital domain and the electronic sounds and stuff like that for influence on this one. And like Matt said, it took me a while to get my head around it, and I was genuinely scared, because I'm afraid of change, I guess.
Yeah, I think we're all feeling that, though. You know, it's hard. You know, we've done something for a long time and very good at it and been very successful at it. So for a lot of people to kind of leave that behind would probably be the most weirdest thing to do.
Yeah.
But it just felt like we had done that a million times. It just wasn't, for me, it wasn't exciting anymore to do that same thing. You know? So I was scared too, and I understand why the boys were even more so, because I couldn't show them what I wanted, because it didn't exist yet.
So. I mean, I think, you know, in parallels a little bit with, you know, one of your idols there, you know, with Metallica, you know, they had the period after you know, a good few years where they needed to make a little bit of a change. Obviously, yeah. This is not as an extreme change as what they did on Load, which these days, you know, and even at the time, these are great records, but at the time there was a backlash.
It is what it is.
I'm talking like this as if there's going to be any backlash. There won't be. It's a fantastic record, but, you know, obviously there's going to be some people who will notice a slight different.
Yeah,
different
that's fine. I hope they do. That's the whole point. Mm. You know, it is different and it is kind of a standout record for us, and it kind of lends itself towards the future of the band, not the past. You know, the past is done.
Absolutely.
Well, you know what? Why do you want to keep dragging that up? It is what it is, and it's been amazing.
That's it.
But it's the future, you know.
And people come to the live shows. Of course, they're going to get to hear, you know, a little bit from all the different eras.
That's never going to go away. We're always going to be playing and embracing that history of the band. But you know, as far as writing goes, we need to shake it up, you know.
Yeah, I think that's the beauty of putting things on record. You kind of immortalize them, so they'll always have that. So you know. Like a backlash of complaining about us changing music. It's like, well, you've got 30 years of these albums, you know, just put them on.
Yeah.
Now, for the live performances, are you the types of guys that you really want to recreate what's on the record, or do you like sort of getting something fresh when you play it live?
Both. We want to play it as accurately and as kind of as well as it is and as flawless it is on the record, but you know, we've already two songs that we're going to be playing at this at the festivals, Letting You Go and Piece of Me, we've already added different live sections to them already, so a bit of both really. It's always nice to add something a bit more vibe, you know. Albums and album versions are album versions for a reason, but live versions, you can take it a little bit further, a little bit more aggressive, you can add a little bit here and there and have a bit more kind of free reign with it, you know.
Absolutely. Now this new record, Gravity, it's just absolutely packed through of amazing choruses. I mean, my God, just like chorus machines, you guys, putting these out, they're so strong. When you're writing these, you know, do you find that you get, does the sort of chorus part to you come to you first? Is there a guitar riff that comes first? Do you get in and jam and then just piece them together? What's the process?
For me personally, it's a bit of all of those things. I can have a vocal melody in my head without any words, literally just a bunch of notes. It can be a guitar riff, it can be a groove or a rhythm that I have in my head. And then you just kind of got to get weird and put it down on Pro Tools and listen to it back, start layering it. And you know probably within the first 30 minutes whether it's going to go anywhere. Mm-hmm. And if it is, then you just roll with it and you just keep going until it's done, I guess, you know. And we tried writing together as a team, we tried writing as individuals. So there's no rules, it is what it is, you know. The more creative juices flowing, the better. The more stuff you've got, the more stuff you can just weed out, and ultimately helps with the quality process. Then, you know?
And have you found that your writing style, has it always been that way, or has it evolved?
I think so, isn't it? It's always been a team and individual efforts, and then everything combined, and it just is what it is. You know, we just roll with as much as we've. You know, the more stuff we have, the better.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes there's a load, sometimes there's not a lot. But it's just, you know, it's a creative art form. It's hard. You can't dictate where that's going to go or how much you're going to have, you know.
And then following Download, you've got a pretty chock-a-block schedule for gigs. You're going to be back in London, I think, towards the end of the year.
Yes.
But where can the fans catch you on tour?
Well, festival season, obviously, all throughout Europe. And if you're UK-based, we're going to be playing London's Alexandra Palace again, which we haven't done since 2008, and Cardiff's Motorpoint Arena. So we're keeping it lean and mean, and then 2019 that'll bring a lot more shows, hopefully. So
fantastic. And you'll be playing in the US as well, though.
We've already done two big tours in the US this year already, but we're going back in September and October for our first headline run, with Gravity actually being out. So
fantastic,
very busy boys.
When you're choosing a venue to play, like especially in London when there's so many options, like why Alexandra Palace, why is that the location for you?
It's a venue we haven't been for 10 years, and it's kind of an arena-sized venue, but with an all-standing crowd, so it's just the vibe is a lot better. It's a lot more energy. I think the crowd like it more when they can get involved, and then they can retreat when they've had enough and then get back into the pit and vibe it up, rather than having been kind of stuck to your seat, you know, with people telling you to sit down every 5 seconds.
So
it's just a bit more of a vibey London venue, and it's a place we haven't been for 10 years, so it's going to be good to get back.
Yeah, no, definitely. Now, just one other thing on the record, gear that was used on there, like what was the setup for guitar-wise?
It was massively simple, as it always is. We never overcomplicated anything. We've actually used Kemper on this one. It's a 5150 profile, which was actually the amp we used on the EP and the Poison. We managed to find it off Andy Sneap. Carl had profiled it, and we used it on Venom, Don't You Do, and now Gravity as well. So 5150 profile tweaked to kind of players' settings.
Yeah.
And the two main tracking guitars was a Les Paul custom with EMG 8185 and a BC Rich Warlock EMG 8185.
Yeah.
And that's it. There's a couple of clean tones on there, you know, like a Valhalla digital kind of delay thing. And some chorusing effects, but it's really basic.
Yeah, no, definitely. And for Padge, I know you like the Kempers as well. Were you using those on there too on the record?
Yeah, same Kemper, everything. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, we just kept it, like I said, simple, and that's it. Just works and for any other guitar, like, because it's a lot less.
Where you just add whatever you want. Yeah. Take anything away. It's just so simple. It revolutionizes the guitar amp, basically.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
It's so.
No, it just makes life so much easier for us. You know what I mean? I think because. The playing side on this one is a lot less technical than it's ever been, so we didn't really have to worry about different tones for octave lines, solo sections, harmonies. You know, it just became really simple.
Yeah.
And it's just crushing because of that. You know, the sound and the guitar tones on this record, they're the best out there. I don't think any other guitar band's got better guitar tones than us right now.
No, bottom line, it sounds fantastic, you know, so whatever you were using for it, you know, that's the end result.
Yeah, it does exactly what we needed to do. So.
You know, well, guys, best of luck with the new album.
Thank you.
The download performance is going to be great. We'll look forward to seeing it. Thanks very much, all right?
Cool, man. Cheers, guys.
Cheers.
Okay, guys, so we're with Padge from Bullet from My Valentine. We're going to take a look at his live rig right here. Padge, you want to talk us through it?
Right, well, obviously I've got my ESP signature models here, drop C tuning, bit of, you know, jiggery-pokery to customise it ourselves. Basically use this guitar, but we got a couple of spares, but we also use these drop pedals, which you can set and you press him and he'll drop half a step.
Oh, okay.
So for B, drop B tuning, we can use a C guitar, but sort of drop him to B, you know, and he ends up sort of, because the tension on the strings is great, but you've got the semitone lower tuning, so it holds up really well, and it sounds great.
Is that something you've always done?
No, just on the last year, I think.
Since the start of this year.
Yeah, so okay. They've been really cool, actually. They work all the time, so it's...
Well, that's the thing. I guess the technology's getting to that point where you just don't notice the difference.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah. So everything's, you know, the algorithm, the rhythms are getting so much better, and like you say, you can barely notice anything.
Absolutely.
Anymore.
So is it just the three ESPs that you take out?
Yeah, pretty much. That's my fly rig, my guitars. They go everywhere with me. One with a whammy bar, Floyd Rose, you know. One spare, just in case, you never know, or D-standard tuning, you know. But that's it, really. I mean, for the most part, I stick to one guitar and just drop him by the pedal.
Awesome. And when you're recording, is it the same three you would use? You ever use anything different?
We've tried them for leads and different tones and stuff. But normally, it's normally a Les Paul, or what I did use on Venom a lot was the Andy James guitar that he gave me, which is a LTD.
Mm.
But different pickups in there. And for the leads, it was nice and creamy and smoother, so... I don't know, maybe a bit more 900, you know, I don't know.
All right, so guitars, about, we look like it's very Kemper orientated here.
Kemper profiling amp. Straight into that, we've got the Venom profiles, which, well, obviously for Venom, and I think it's the same one for the new album Gravity, but they're all installed in here. My effects, my clean tones, obviously they're all triggered into the foot switch.
Mm.
But what we've done recently is MIDI changes.
Yeah, from the playback.
From the playback. So the playback triggers my pedal changes all via MIDI. So Tom doesn't have to do anything. I don't have to do anything. It all does it automatically. So it's like, yes, sorcery. But it's so much easier, you know, because people can concentrate on other things. I can play my guitar instead of
absolutely
foot tapping and stuff. And
What about the sound on stage? Do you still have like the, you know, like the feeding back a little bit like it would be an amplifier?
Yeah, we have the front monitors wedges here, so we get a bit of ring, you know, get a bit of feedback and stuff.
So you just don't notice any difference with the Kemper at all compared to...
No, the only thing is that, you know, you haven't got a speaker region deafening you behind, because we use in-ear monitors.
which are connected to a monitor rig. So if people watch a side stage, very different, weird sound. You can mostly hear drums, well, only hear drums, and then whatever's coming back from the PA. So it's a bit of a mess on stage, but, you know, when you put ears in, you, it's clear as day, and then, you know, the sound guy and the crowd out front, they get to hear it all spot on, and it's really clean, it's really nice, there's no bleed into the mics apart from drums, but, you know, a bit of jiggery-pokery there, and he tries to cut as much out as he can.
Absolutely, and any effects?
All built in. We just add out delays or choruses or, you know, just add it onto whatever profile, save it to a pedal. And that's about it, really. I've got my wah-wah.
Okay.
With a Q pedal on it, a Q knob or whatever, and that's it, really.
And the wah, it's, which brand's it? Dunlop?
Yeah, all is Dunlop, yeah. Yeah, recently playing with a bad Aussie in my studio, and I don't know, maybe a change is on the way.
Yeah.
But, yeah. But we'll see.
All right, Padge, thanks so much for talking us through this.
No worries. Thanks a lot. Cheers.
Okay, guys, so we're with Matt Tuck from Bullet for My Valentine. He's going to talk us through his live rig. You want to take it away, Matt?
Sure. Basically, these are the guitars that I use on the road. And for warming up, these are two Kirk Hammett replica 79 Gibson Flying Vs. So they are pretty badass little things. They look amazing. Very comfortable to play. Sound sick. Yeah, I think there's only 200 of these made as well. So I've got number 8 and 85, which is kind of cool.
Very cool. Always had the EMGs in them?
Yep, always had them. Well, ever since I was a young Metallica fan. You know, this one doesn't have EMGs, but this was my first proper kind of live touring guitar. Back in about 2005, I acquired this off lovely people at Jackson. And yeah, it's appeared in multiple videos. It appeared in our first Live at Brixton kind of DVD and stuff. And guitar, I still don't use it live anymore. It's more just kind of a backup, just in case. But yeah, it's an awesome guitar. It's seen a lot of action, and it took a bit of a dive at Reading 2008. Had a bit of a moment and launched it, and it didn't land very well. But Jackson took it back, and they repaired it all, and it's better than ever.
Well, you seem to have more of a connection to this instrument there. Is that?
Yeah, well, like I said, it was back when the band first started taking off, and I used Jackson guitars anyways, and then the guys at Jackson endorsed me and gave me a bunch of stuff, and this was my first proper kind of USA RR1 guitar, you know? So I used this pretty much as soon as I got it, and used it up until about 2012 or 13 when I moved to BC Rich temporarily. But yeah, it has a lot of sentimental value, and it's a guitar that, you know, the Bullet hardcore fans know exactly what this is, you know? Sure. So
have you had to refret these guitars?
This did when it went back to Jackson, because it got all cracked up here and stuff, and then they repaired it. Like, I don't even know how they did it.
You'd never be able to tell.
It's incredible. And then they changed the white logo to a gold logo then, which has a bit of a meaning if you're a guitar nerd. So there's that one, which is great. And this guitar here, this Les Paul. Again, this is just, I bought a lot of guitars over the years, so I just brought, it is what it is. It's Les Paul. Custom. We changed those out, obviously, and then we changed all the hardware to black hardware to make it look a bit more rock and roll, a bit more gnarly looking. Used this guitar to track all of Venom, Don't Need You, and most of Gravity. So I just take it on the road just to kind of warm up, have it in the dressing room and on the bus, and just a good guitar to play and warm up with, you know? So
yeah. It's quite rare to see, you know, an artist that's actually using these guitars on the record on the road as well, but that's it, isn't it? You get the one you're happy with, and then you stick with it.
It's beautiful, you know, it plays well, it sounds insane. It's comfortable. You sit down in the restroom all day and play, rather than these things, they're ridiculous. You can't, you know, it's after 10 minutes your leg is dead. So I just make sure that I take a decent normal guitar out just to play.
It's kind of interesting that with the Jackson there, you've got the passive pickups on there. Do you find that, like, because obviously it seems like the active ones are more your preference, do you notice a difference?
Yeah, they sound and they feel a lot different, because we use obviously these things as well, the in-ear monitors, you know, it really, you can hear every little nuance of sound, really. So for me, it wasn't something that I did on purpose. It was just something I got a guitar with EMGs loaded in it, and sound guy preferred them. And okay. You know, they sound, they got a bit more of a kind of a aggressive edge to them than the passive pickups, you know. So for this style of music, they just become a bit of an industry standard, really. But these ones are immense, you know, they're super high output as well.
Mm.
And, you know, with the tweak of gain and, you know, digging in hard on stage, you can't really hear the difference, to be honest. But.
For sure. Okay, so I had a look at the guitars. Let's have a look at this amplifier setup now.
Rack mounted Kemper. Everything's dialed in via this foot switch here, which Mac does for me, so I don't have to do it and worry about it on stage. Got a tuner, kind of selector for A and B guitars, so we just bump switch guitars. This is a drop pedal. I'm sure Padge already showed you this anyways. Yeah. So we've got a lot of the new songs of Gravity are in drop B.
Mm-hmm.
So instead of faffing around with bringing more guitars on the road and more tunings and more guitar changes, just pop that and off we go. We're ready to roll straight away. So.
When did you make this switch over to the Kempers for your live sound?
On the Venom cycle, about 2015. Mm. So up until then.
You were pretty early on that then.
Yeah. We got on board early with it and did the transition. You know, we kind of rebelled against it for a long time. Being a bit of a purist at heart, but, you know, it just makes what we do so much easier, the logistics of it. We can take this anywhere, you know. You can get, obviously, the carry ones of these. So we just take our sounds wherever we go. So if you turn up in Sao Paulo after a gig, you know, you've got your rig. You don't have to rely on crappy rental gear, which doesn't work and is just not even close to the sound you want or need, you know.
Have you found that, because it's really interesting you were doing it all the way back then, because a lot of people say, like, it's only in the last couple of years that it's really made a difference. Have you noticed the difference, like, the improvement in the Kemper, even over the, or were you always thinking that it's good to go right from, I mean, you wouldn't have used
it,
obviously.
Yeah, it was always, I mean, just getting the profile right is the key thing. Mm. And as soon as you're happy with that, there's no difference, you know. Mm. Apart from it's just so much easier, it's far more cost effective, because you don't have to fly these huge rigs anymore, you know what I mean? They cost a fortune, you know, and the consistency you have with your tones is priceless. So it just works on every single level.
Absolutely. So we've got the Kempers here, we've got your multiple profiles. Mm-hmm. What about effects?
Effects, again, they're just kind of loaded in here. I have, for a couple of clean songs, this one's got Venom, for example.
Mm-hmm.
It's got a delay and a chorus and a reverb on there. It's just really basic stuff, you know, but it's all, because we play to a click, the delays are put in time with the click. Mm-hmm. So it's just beautiful and perfect every time you play.
Of course, with you having, you know, constant vocals, you don't want any extra distractions. So.
No, it is. That's why I think, you know, keeping my rig as simple and as clean as possible, it's just one less thing to worry about.
Yeah.
You know, I got to be focusing on singing as well as playing, so I got split my brain, which is a nightmare. It's cool, yeah. So simplicity has always been the key for me as a guitar player. I don't like messing around with 20 different effects pedals, and I've never been that guy. I just like crushing tones. Good kind of technique.
Yeah, well, you got that, that's for sure. Matt, thanks so much for taking some time.
No problem. Thanks, man.